Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Reach Wesleyan Church. This is our Bridge Sunday, as we call it. I don't know if we've actually said that too much, but it was kind of a cute little thing. We're over here now. And apparently everybody remembered, so that's good. Or at least those of you that are here. I did put signs on the door just in case somebody shows up over there so that they know where to go. But it is good to have you. We have done a lot of work in the last 3 years or so. And if you were not here yesterday for open house, I'd encourage you afterwards, go wander and see the Sunday school wing and see what's been done back there. We want you to see it now because it's all nice and fresh and new and clean. Okay? I can't promise it's going to stay like that. In fact, I hope it doesn't stay like that. But we got kids in there and they make a little bit of a mess. But it is good to have everyone. If you're online this morning, we're glad that you're with us, and we're hoping that the internet is going to be okay. We're going to have to work on that, so please be patient with us. If not, it is still recording, and we'll get it up there later, and we'll post it so everybody can see it, or watch it again, or whatever you want to do. Also, just kind of remember, bear with us. There's still little things around that are need to be done and need to be finished, and if you want to help with anything, if you see something that needs to be done, talk to him. William's been the one in charge of this, and he's done a great job orchestrating it. A couple of announcements this morning as we get going. If you have not picked up one of these blue pieces of paper, that is your guidebook to Christmas, at least our Christmas. That has got all the events going on from now until the new year. One of the things coming up, can you believe it's Thanksgiving week? I don't believe Thanksgiving week. Can you believe that the Christmas parade is Saturday night? Did you know that? Wesleyan Parade of Lights is Saturday night. Yes, Mallory, it's Saturday night. I forgot to ask, when are we going to get together to do a float? We got all the stuff, but we're going to put it together. What?
We're going to
track it. I'm sure. Friday or Saturday?
Sure.
Day for us all.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. foremost, we are here to worship. I mean, we've done a lot of work, and we've had a lot to rejoice and thankful over, but first and foremost, we're here to worship this morning. And so let's prepare our hearts. We're going to sing some songs. We're going to have a couple of people that maybe you haven't seen in a while, or maybe one you haven't seen before. That's okay. I guarantee he's good to be here. I'll introduce him in a minute, but our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 133, verses 1 to 3. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down the beard, running down Aaron's beard, down the collar of his robe. This is the dew of Hermon, falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life evermore. If you would stand, your choruses are in your bulletin this morning. We did not wait that one. We haven't quite got done yet, but we will get there. We'll just have to read it on paper. Also, when we get to the hymns, your hymnal is onto the seats. Great and mighty is he.
Mighty is he.
Amherst Wesleyan. We've got them with Peter Moore, and I'm going to ask him to come up and share with us an invocation of prayer.
Well, let's pray together. Lord, Heavenly Father, maker of heaven and earth, the one who was and is to come, how great you are. Lord, you've given us an incredible milestone, an incredible blessing today. Not only is it a new start, renovation, something, a new work maybe. God, it is a fulfillment of a promise that you are not done. That you are still here. And you are still working. And God, we are here today asking for your presence. Asking for the tangible flowing of your Holy Spirit on us as we gather here. And as we take this moment to celebrate, to imagine, to dream, to come together, God, we pray that your Holy Spirit would fill this place, that we would feel your presence, that we would know your voice, and that the songs we sing and the things we do would be a satisfying offering for you. May you come and have your way in this service. That your kingdom would come. And your will be done. On earth, in our hearts, in this place, like it is in heaven. And we pray these things with the authority of Jesus.
If you want to remain standing, you can. If you need to sit, that's fine too. We're going to continue singing, Mighty is Our God.
Mighty is our God. Mighty is our King. Mighty is our Lord. you may be seated.
Peter Moore, our district superintendent, is here. He's going to share a few words. And he said he was going to keep it short.
Start the clock.
Sacrifice and obedience for the sake of mission. That's what we just sang about. Like a rose trampled on the ground, he took the fall so that we could have a right relationship with him. Sacrifice plus obedience for the sake of mission. That formula is what God has blessed in the hearts of the people in the Loacation region. And here are we. When you think of the 100-plus years of history of two churches that God led to become one church, and all of the lives that have been impacted, we celebrate many things today, but most of all, we celebrate that we are called to be a people of sacrifice and obedience for the sake of His mission. And I would be doing you a disservice today if I did not speak openly about the fact that us being here for this service has been the result of sacrifice for some. And I want to acknowledge that. I want to honor you, because when a church comes together like this church has, because of its history, we all have a different starting point that has led us to this point. We do not doubt that God has called us to this Bridge Sunday. I love the name, Pastor Andy, that you folks came up with for this Sunday. Partly because I think it has tied in wonderfully with how the actual bridge construction has come. I was not here. The last time I was here, the bridge was not yet completed. And that was kind of inconvenient, I guess is a nice way to say it. And you folks have all lived with that now for a number of years as they've been working on it. And you know, it's interesting, that bridge, which is a man-made bridge for man-made reasons, is not unlike the bridge that we have built and crossed as a church family over the past few years. Many of you, most of you, were in rooms when we had our Maximizing Impact weekend, and when we talked about what it would look like for us to consider sacrifice and obedience for the sake of mission. And my friends, you stood courageously to make decisions about the future of the kingdom for Jonesport and Beals and for the Loacation region. You stood courageously and said, I will play my part to see his kingdom continue to come on earth as it is in heaven. And so that bridge took us several years to build. And while there's still a few more spots in the building, maybe a little bit of trim here or there, a coat of paint on this or that, we are 90% where we wanted to be. And we celebrate that here on this Bridge Sunday, we now cross over to the bookend of this transition that God called us to create for his kingdom's sake. And Brother Willis, I want to say to you, sir, and also William to you, as the vice chairs of the two previous churches, the incredible work that you invested in this transition is immeasurable. It's known only to God how you've invested your time and your influence to see this day here.
Amen.
And we honor you, and I would like you to join me in thanking these men for all they have done for this day. There has been obedience, but there has been lots of sacrifice. And here we are today on this one.
wonderful day, and your words were so fitting, Willis, to see the church full of worshipers again and to see a bright future for this new church and this new day. And so we thank God for that. And I also want to, on behalf of our district family, say a very, very strong and deep word of appreciation for our pastor, Pastor Andrew. Because God has used him mightily to guide us and to walk with us through this transition. And here we are today at the bookend of that transition on this Bridge Sunday. And we are in smooth sailing to the days ahead. And we wouldn't have gotten here without you and your leadership. So would you join me in thanking God?
Stroke, but
Continue to pray for him. They have a lot of work to do in the house that they need to get him home and make sure it's ready. I know Sandy mentioned that her brother-in-law should be coming home next month, and there's work that needs to be done there. But he is dating. What else?
Remember the family of Benny Beal who passed today?
Benny passed away?
Benny Beal.
Okay, I did not hear that yet. Was that just last night?
So I think it was last night.
Okay. All right, so remember the Benny Beal family. What else this morning?
We had asked prayer for my wife's two brothers, and both with heart conditions, and they've seen some real improvement. There's still prayer needed, but we appreciate the fact that people have been praying for that.
Okay.
Sue Mills.
Sue?
I saw Stevie Crowley on Thursday. He's doing as well as he's expected. He was out walking. He walks with a limp, so the cancer is progressing.
Okay.
Charlie Smith and Sandy both.
All right. This week we did have a fire in Jonesport. Young man was living there. He was out of the house actually when it started. Kind of ironic. He just went to the fire company. His first structure fire was his own house.
Wow.
The whistle apparently got on fire. He got his dog out, and that was it. So pray for Alex and as he gets going. He says, I'm not too worried about most things. He says, I didn't have a whole lot of stuff. I live pretty minimally, but he's just rolling with it. And but pray for him. It's got to be an upheaval, definitely.
She's doing good. She's doing well.
That's Daphne?
Yes.
Yes.
Pray that continues.
Clyde Jr.
And the family of Cuff Johnson.
Yes. Yeah, Cuff passed away last week, wasn't it? Early last week?
Last week.
Sherry Clayton.
Yes.
Yeah, Sherry's had some problems this week. And keep her in prayer. Bert still has a procedure coming up, right?
He had a procedure last week. He's expecting the results this week, and depending on whether they found cancer in the lung, will determine whether they also biopsy the next lung. So pray for him.
Okay. Any unspoken requests? You want to just raise a hand and wave at me? Okay. I see that. We're going to sing our prayer chorus, Praise the Name of Jesus. It is Thanksgiving week. How can you not be thankful for being here, being alive, being able to do everything we do? But we also lift these requests before the Lord. Let's pray. But let's sing.
Amen.
Father, I just pray that you would take and minister to us in this hour, that your Spirit would continue to be here, continue to pour out on us, teach us. Father, empower us. We thank you for all the things that you have done, not just when we think of the renovations, but the way you brought us through this week, and you watched over us, and you cared for us, and you have given us health and life, and so many blessings. Father, you are a great God. But this morning, our hearts also turn to those that need help. The world likes to think of help coming from many different places other than you. But we know there's only one true great physician, only one true help in time of trouble, and so we come to you. We pray for Sherry, that you continue to watch over her with her health concerns. We think of Pastor Nick as he's had health concerns, and ask that you watch over him. We pray that you be with Stevie, with Sue. This morning we pray for Heidi, we pray for Daphne as she recovers. We think of Dougie as he's still healing but getting better, and we pray that you be able to help them get the house ready for him. We pray for Roy as well, that they will be able to come home soon, especially the night of Christmas. That would be awesome. Father, we think of Bert as he's had this test, his waiting results. Give him a peace and give him a healing. Reach down and touch him. We think this morning of the unspoken requests that have been indicated, and you know that all the details. We think of other family members that we have concerns over, both physically and also otherwise. Father, give us wisdom as we go about our days, that we know best how to help and how to love and how to be with people. Father, we pray for families that have lost loved ones. We know so many around here that have, and ask them to be close to them. We think especially today of the Johnson family and the Ben Gilles family. Father, what a sad parting, what a time to say goodbye. And we just ask that you would be close to them, comfort them, strengthen them. We know that there is a lot going on in our nation. In our world, we ask that you, giving our leaders wisdom and help, we ask that you watch over our servicemen and women, wherever they are, whether they're here or abroad, that you protect them, give them strength for their jobs, and bring them safely back to their families and friends. Father, I think of our missionaries for the fields that they're on. Father, I pray that you would be with them and help guide them, help show them the people that are ready to listen and hear, the way your Spirit's already working in their lives. And Father, you put a mission field right in front of us, right in our front yard here. Father, help us to minister to the people that we run into every day. Help us to be your people, loving and caring and serving day by day. As we look at your words this morning, give us something that we can learn about you and that we can take with us as we go. For it is in your precious holy name. Gotta get excited, don't we? It is Thanksgiving week, though, so let's put off Christmas for just a little bit. I know I'd rather be there right now. I told Tammy last night, I said, you know, Rachel's already begging us to get the tree up, so I don't know when we're going to go, but I guess it's going to be really soon. But this is Thanksgiving week, so let's focus on Thanksgiving, and we've got a lot to be thankful for. As I mentioned, we have done an awful lot. I'm thankful that we're at the point where I don't have to get down on my knees too much anymore. I'm just being honest. This old fat body isn't doing that as well anymore. And I know I'm not as old as some. Just some days I feel it, okay? Let me have that. But Thanksgiving week, what are you thankful for? That attitude of gratitude, I always like that phrase. That attitude of gratitude is something we've got to cultivate. It doesn't really happen naturally, does it? What do we tend to do naturally? We tend to go back to the, why did that happen? Why isn't this way? Why did this have to be today? What? We grumble and we complain about it. And let's be honest, we do that. So we have to kind of force ourselves to choose gratitude. And God has blessed us in so incredibly much. As a church, as individuals, as families. I mean, just the fact that we get to live in this country, sorry to the comedians that are in the room. But God has blessed us so much. And we need to foster that thankfulness. We need to choose that thankfulness. It's no secret that in the history of Israel, they had a very up and down relationship with. If you look through, you know, they were led out of Egypt by Moses, and they were barely a couple days into the desert, they were already complaining. Why don't you just take us back? We had more food, we had more water there. We don't care, we were slaves, we want to go back. But Moses led them through the desert at God's command. Truly, truly God led them, right? Pillar of fire, pillar of cloud went before them, led the way every step. But because of their lack of faith, they could have, in just a few couple of short weeks, been in the promised land. But they said, no, they're too big. They'll overpower us. We can't do it. And they were right. They couldn't do it. But God had promised that he would give them that land. And so they had rejected God's promise, and they ended up wandering 40 years in the desert. When they finally went into the promised land under Joshua's leadership, they again rejected one of God's commands. Go in and wipe out all the people that are there. Start anew. Start afresh. Get rid of the Canaanites and their gods and their evil practices and their idolatry. And they didn't. Oh, no, we can live with them. What happens? That creeps back into Jewish society, Israel society. And they fall away from God. And we see in the book of Judges especially, everyone did what was right in their own eyes. They fell away from God, and then the judges raised up by God, and the people start complaining because, oh, this country is oppressing us. Well, you know, God didn't promise to bless us when we're not following him, right? So they come back to God. God delivers them. They follow God for the life of that judge, and then they repeat the cycle again. Then they reject God completely and say, we want a human king. We don't want this divine leadership. We want a human king that we can see, we can touch, we can talk to, and we want him to lead us. And so God gave in, said, you know, here's Saul, follow him. I mean, God was still there. The tabernacle was still there. God's presence was still felt. But they had distanced themselves. And during Saul's reign, there was conflict with the Philistines, especially back and forth. Eventually, in a battle, Saul was killed. And now it's David's turn. David, the young shepherd boy, who had been anointed already, had been waiting for his time under God's command to take the reins of leadership. And I find it interesting, we're going to be in 1 Chronicles today. Excuse me. I find it interesting, one of the first things after the Philistines are defeated, Because David goes out, he's a mighty warrior in battle, he's got great men, they go out, they fight the Philistines, they defeat him. One of the first things is they recover the Ark of the Covenant and they sell it. There's still the end of the war moment. There is still the remnants of the Philistines to track down properly. There is still rebuilding to do. There is still death and dying all around them. And they've lost comrades and people all over the place, and yet they stop and have a day of celebration. Why? Because the presence of God is with us. The Ark of the Covenant is back where it belongs. The Ark of the Covenant was a symbol of God with his people. It was made at God's command by Moses. In it were the Ten Commandments and a jar of manna and Aaron's staff. And it says actually at one point that when the ark was placed in the tabernacle of the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest went once a year, that when it was first put there, the Spirit of God descended like a cloud on the place. A visible representation that God was with his people. And in 1 Chronicles 16, we see the ark being put back into its rightful place. I say rightful place because it was not the tabernacle, it was not a temple at that point. It was a tent, and you'll see that in a second, that David erected, but it was sacrificed and consecrated and made sacred before God, and so it was the right place at the right time. I give you all that so you can understand what's going on here in chapter 16 of 1 Chronicles. Because you need to know the backstory, we need to know where we've been in order to know where we're going. Now, I have picked out a few verses here and there. I didn't want to read 50 verses or whatever it is, chapter 16. I didn't think you wanted to listen to 50 verses. So we're going to jump around a little bit, but we're just basically going to go through the chapter and hit the highlights here. It says here, verse 1. They brought the ark of God and set it in the tent that David had pitched, and they presented burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before God. After David had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord. Then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each Israelite man and woman. I don't know how many were there. That's a lot of baking that somebody did. He appointed some of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord, to exalt, thank, and praise the Lord God of Israel. That day, David first approached Asaph and his associates to give praise to the Lord in this manner. And this is actually a psalm. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the heart of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord in his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wonders that he has done, the miracles and the judgments he has pronounced. You, his servants, the descendants of Israel, his chosen ones, the children of Jacob. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are on all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the promise he made for 1,000 generations. The covenant made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. To you I will give the land of Canaan as the portion of your inheritance. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save me, God our Savior. Save us, God our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory Praise to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said, Amen, and praise the Lord. David left Asaph and his associates before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to minister there regularly according to each day's requirements. I love how this ends. Then all the people left, each to their own home, and David returned to bless his family. Three things this morning I want to bring out from this passage. The first one is remembering God's covenant. We need to know where we've been, don't we? We're going to talk a little bit about our history in a second, but to start with, Israel knew the covenant of Abraham. Israel knew the law that had been given to Moses. Israel was taught from the time they were a child by their parents and by the priests. They were taught, and it was reviewed, it was gone over and over again, and they, just like we do in Sunday school, just like we do in church, they go over and over and over so that we know it. They knew. And David says here in this, remember. Remember the covenant. Remember God's faithfulness to the covenant. David tells the people that God is faithful. He's not forgotten. He has not wandered away. He's not left them. He's remembered the covenant he made. In a similar way, we remember the new covenant that God has made with us. When Jesus came, he took the old covenant and, I guess the best way to say it, is he perfected it. He gave us two commands, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, in all of these laws, all of these covenant practices, all of these traditions are summed up in those. If you can do those perfectly, you will have the heart of what God wants you to. He also said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything I have taught you. We have an obligation. We need to remember, though, so that we can teach. You can't teach something you don't remember, can you? Will you ever try to teach something you don't remember?
Yes. That doesn't always go well.
What do you remember? Do you remember when you first came to church, maybe searching? Do you remember when you first came to God, asking him who he was and what he was about? Do you remember when you first made a commitment to God and followed Jesus Christ? I remember. Somebody's playing. I remember I was just shy of 5 years old. I was laying about 10 o'clock at night on an old couch in my grandmother's cabin at our church camp in West Jersey, New York. And I remember at almost 5 years old, something had hit me from the service that night that I realized, I guess I better do that. I better follow Jesus. And so I made that decision. Everybody else in the cabin sleeping. Just a little bit, a little me. And then I told them the next morning. Of course, my grandmother was really thrilled. My grandmother was a prayer warrior in the family anyways. But that's where it started. Do you remember where it started for you? Do you remember how you felt when you made that decision to follow Christ? Maybe it was relief, maybe it was peace, maybe it was something else. We need to remember where we were. Because God is faithful. He keeps his covenant promises. And he's made a promise to you. I'm going to leave you and never forsake you. I will be with you always. To the end of the age. I will protect you and hold you up. I know sometimes it feels like this world just presses in. But we can rest in God's hand and he will protect. And even when the bad things do happen, they are still temporary because eventually, at the end of the book, it says we win. And we go to him. And we live with him. So remember where we've been because it's going to make you stronger and encourage you when you are going and where we end up. And it'll help you as you talk to others and minister to them. The second thing is you need to give thanks to God. It's not just enough to remember. We can remember a lot of things. But do you thank God for what you've been through? Do you thank God for where you've been, what he's brought you to this point? You're all here. That's something to be thankful for. Especially the last few years with the pandemic and everything, people are not very thankful. And if you don't realize that, you don't work in retail. Retail workers have taken a hard hit because people are nasty. I know things don't go our way. I know there's challenges ahead. I know that the grocery bills and the gas bills have gone up. I know there's uncertainty about the heating season. I know that we have some, well, it's not even talking about the livelihood around here and the attack that's under. Mm-hmm. It's all serious. I'm not making light of it by any means. But by the other hand, we also have so much. When you think back 100 years to what the people had, or maybe I should say didn't have, we had an awful lot. We have an awful lot to be thankful for. But thankfulness is a choice. You need to choose. It doesn't come naturally. You need to make that choice, just like everything else. If you're going to be good, you need to make that choice. If you're going to follow God, you need to make that choice. If you're going to be thankful, you need to make that choice. Choose good. Choose thankfulness. Choose to look at your life a little differently. I am thankful for so many different things. I'm thankful that God has given me two of the best jobs I think in the world. I love standing up here and being able to present his word. I didn't just say that 2 years ago. But I also love being in the back of that box right down the road at 7 miles an hour trying to save people's lives. And there's some days I'm not sure which I look better, to be quite honest with you. But I'm so thankful that God has allowed me to do what I do.
Amen.
I'm so thankful that I've got my family and my friends. So thankful that we live in a beautiful place. You guys have really spoiled us, honestly. Or God has or something. I'm not sure where it's all coming from. I'm thankful for electricity and tech gadgets. My nerd side didn't come out there. And I promise you, I'm going to try not to nerd out too much on the history, but I am going to give you some history. I love that we live in a free country. And I know we're not going to get started on something. Sometimes you just got to stop and say, this is what I like right now. This is what I'm thankful for right now. We need to remind ourselves and choose to be thankful. I'm thankful for all the blessings God has provided. But secondly, when we choose, we need to choose to find the blessings and practice them in our lives as what's good in those lives. It's not enough to have a faith that is just inward. You have to bring it out to other people. Somebody in this room even could benefit from something you've heard or felt or seen or been blessed with. And all it takes sometimes is a conversation to encourage them. Somebody in the community, do you realize every person that walks in a room changes that room a little bit by their attitude? Every single person. So every one of you in here is adding to the whole ambiance of this room this morning. So what happens if you've got somebody that is extremely down and negative? They can bring the whole room down. Versus the person that's excited, kids went to the bonkers before you left the house. You had a flat tire on the way there, and you walk into the room, you're just kind of, right? We've been there. But you still have a choice, don't you? How are you going to handle it? And I know we don't always handle it right. But if we can handle it better today than we did yesterday, we're on the right track. Thank God for your blessings. And finally, I mentioned earlier, I love that last verse. They end there with, the people left, each to their own home, and David went back to bless his family. I don't know what that means, honestly. But it shows that David, the warrior king, David that had all this responsibility now for this country, David that's just ministered before the Lord, he's drunk and tired, David that could have been doing 100 other things went home to be with his family. It was a priority. And I know family runs deep around here. You all tell me who you relate to, and you pretty much all relate to each other. Tammy even found relationships with the Beale family, so I'm strong too, I guess. But your family is important. Your family needs you. Now, your first priority should be God. Because it is God that's going to teach you how to lead your family. It's God that's going to teach you how to be the best person that you can be. It's God that's going to, you know, show up and strengthen you for whatever is ahead. But boy, you've got to focus on your family. And I think that means not only your physical family, your biological family, but also your church family. Because we are a family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. How are you blessing your family? Are you leading well? God will help you live well. We can't do it on our own. On our own, we mess it up, we screw it up. And today, as we celebrate, we remember all that God has done. We give thanks for all that He has brought us through and to this point, all that He has blessed us with. With faith, believing that He's going to continue ahead. Because His faithfulness continues to all generations. And as we leave later today, we're going to go out and bless our family and hopefully bless our community through the course of this next week. David could have been doing so many things. Politically, he had so many things on his plate, but he chose to take a day and celebrate God. That's what we're doing. We're celebrating God in our midst. Now, don't anybody jump on me, because this is not an exhaustive history, okay? This is the bullet high points. Because if we wanted to do an exhaustive history of two churches coming together as one another, we'd be here for another 100 years. Trust me. If you are interested in a little more detail, on the back little table there is a couple of items from both churches. History of Jonesport, Wesleyan, and a couple of histories of Beale's Wesleyan from 66 and 76 and I think 96. I just put them back there and look at it. There's also a picture, and I thought this was interesting. I came across this. There's a picture of the dedication of the Sunday school rooms when they were first built. So you might want to check out the table if you're interested in history. If you're not, you're going to glaze over in this part. I know. But we're going to have a little bit of history, remembering where we came from, remembering what God has done. And then we're going to have a rededication of this facility and us as a church. Because the church is not the building, is it? No. The church is us. We are the church. The building is simply the place where we can get together. So, Beale's Wesleyan Church, Jonesport Wesleyan Church, the Reach Wesleyan Church, they weren't always Wesleyan. The Reformed Baptists are the ones that started the work here. You've got to give credit to them. The Beale's Reformed Baptist Church was founded and organized in 1895. I don't think any of us were around then. You were, I didn't talk to you. Under the leadership of Reverend Dan Hilliard. Daniel Hilliard is what the Hilliard Building is named after. It's what the big window in the back is dedicated to. He was a sea captain. And by his own admission, he was a hard man on screw. But when he got saved, he changed. He started following God, and he wanted a church that he could worship in. And so he led it. Reformed Baptists came in, helped him organize that. They dedicated this building originally, just this part, in 1898. A little more than a dozen years later, around 1912, the Jonesport Reformed Baptist Church was organized by the Reverends G.W. Henderson and Horatio Cosman. Although I found another record that said that Reverend J.H. Coy and S.A. Bakers were also involved in that organization. So apparently it took more to get Jonesport going than it did here. I'm not sure. But the next year, 1913, was when Reverend Mary Ella Slip pastored for almost 10 years and then came back a little later. And it was under her leadership that they erected the building that is over there. It was, the cornerstone was laid in 1917, and the dedication of the building was in 1919. So I guess 2 years isn't too bad, right, for renovation. I mean, they took 2 years to do the original buildings and stuff. An interesting side note, Reverend Slip, she was also very involved in a pandemic. Ministered to a lot of people around the area that nobody else would go near because of, I think, believe it was influenza pandemic. And she was, I don't know, I feel a connection. Through the respective histories of each church, there have been many distinguished and beloved pastors and their families that have come through these doors. They've each added their little bit to Jonesport and Beals. And as a board, we took and we sent out invitations to some of those that are still around, and due to a lot of circumstances, none were able to be with us this morning, but they send greetings. Pastor Glenn especially sent me a nice note saying that he wished he could be here, and he loves everyone, and he's praying for us. Pastor Rich wished he could be here today, but Peter had in on some other assignments. But they'll show up sometime, I'm sure they will. Pastor Nick, we already mentioned, he would love to be here. Buildings have changed. Well, even the name has changed. Because we're not Reformed Baptists anymore, are we? And if you don't know the history of our denomination, in 1966, the Reformed Baptists merged with the Wesleyan Methodists and formed a new denomination. And then 2 years later, they decided to merge somebody else. And the Building of Holiness came on board. They came on board. And so in 68, that is where the Wesleyan Church, the full title, came from, that we know now. The buildings have changed, Beals added on, a pipe organ first, I believe it was, and then over here, and then the Sunday school rooms, even making some offices. Jonesport added an addition with office space and a bathroom, and then a basement, ended up with a kitchen and some classrooms down below. Members have changed. People have come and gone. Some very influential people promoted to glory. People that these churches would not be here without them. And each one has contributed in some way to the life and ministry of our church body and our community. Ministries have changed. Who remembers Christian Youth Crusaders? CYC program. What about YMWB? Young Missionary Workers Band. Over the years, that became Kids Club and then WKFM. Wesleyan Kids for Missions. Always sounds like a radio station. pioneer clubs at one point, and most recently we've had Awana. Now we've kind of adopted again the kids club moniker, and you know, we've got different things we're doing. But we're still reaching kids and teens. This year we saw a young adult group get started, led by the young adults themselves. I told them I didn't want any part of it. They can do what they want, as long as it was within reason. They've done a good job. We've had leadership come up from our kids, our teenagers. Our Christmas play this year is being led by Sarah and Rachel. We've had Sunday school and junior church being led by the kids and the teens and young adults. I'm not really kids, but the teens and young adults. We do have a limit there. We've seen music change. Well, maybe we haven't changed as much as some churches. I'm just going to say that. We've seen the addition of audiovisual stuff and sound. We've seen the change into social media and live streaming and connecting with people that aren't even in our building. But one thing has remained the same through all that, and that is preaching God and His truth, His word. And it has been faithfully preached here for years, and it will continue to do so. In 2019, we began that historic merger that brought us to this point where we call ourselves the Reach Wesleyan Church. Our vision is reaching out with God's love to all people. That's our mission. That's our desire, is to see people come to know God. And we stand here today ready to do something new and different. Using this building Sunday mornings and using the building over there for other things. And, you know, it was actually kind of nice not having to set up chairs this week after Trudy messed everything up with the shoeboxes. And actually, it's good. The timing of this has been great, too, because she's still got shoeboxes coming in. What do you got, 175 now?
176.
Wow.
And I've had numerous messages this morning, so it should be busy this afternoon.
Now, 101 of those were the ones we brought in. The admins brought in 60-something. Mm-hmm. And then people in the community have stopped by, one or two at a time. And tomorrow, they're all going to go to campus. That's 176 lives, actually more than that, probably some over 700 or 800 lives that are going to be touched. Now, don't worry about that. They're going to be touched with the gospel of Christ, because that's something we can do. But there's other things, too. Young adult programs, youth programs, kids programs, Bible studies, outreaches, movie nights. We're going to do all those over there. But we're here today because God is faithful. And what people that were faithful to follow God started 127 years ago, we're going to keep going. As long as we have strength and breath, we're going to keep going. And we want to praise God. We want to praise God with a declaration before Him that we are going to dedicate ourselves to this church building, to this community, and to mostly His service. You know, we had a great time yesterday at the open house. A bunch of people stopped by. But before we had the open house, a few of us, some board members and some others, met out here and we went through every room and prayed. William, you made us do the bathroom.
Yeah.
He pays attention to details that I don't really think. Why do we do that? Because it's not about necessarily the wood and the putty and the paint and the things that that needs away. It's about the people that are going to come through these doors.
Right.
You and others.
Amen.
And if God's not leading us, then we're not going to do anything worth doing. So we pray for God's continued presence. We pray for the teachers. We pray for the students. We pray for the work that God is going to do in lives through this. Now, if you want to know anything else, there's a lot of other people. You can ask anybody that knows the churches that have been here a while. They can tell you their stories. That's kind of the highlights, right? That's the stuff to get us going. Wipe your appetite. Like I promise, I'm not going to geek out completely. But we want to have a rededication here. And to start off, I actually want to sing a hymn. And William's going to fire up the old whiteboard. And we're going to hope everything's working right. He's got one key to his signal, but if he gets that one, we'll know it. But number 767, in your hymnal. It's also it's a good Thanksgiving. We gather together. Then you're going to need your, the blue piece of paper in your bulletin. You're going to need that afterwards. We're going to go through that for the rededication. We gathered together to ask the Lord to bless them. Brotherhood In charity and goodwill to all,
we dedicate ourselves.
In remembrance of those who began this work, faithfully following God's leading to impact their community and gave us a legacy on which we can build,
we dedicate this house.
In gratitude for the labors of those who love and serve this church, in loving remembrance of those who have finished their course in the hope of blessed immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord,
we dedicate this house.
We now, the people of this church and congregation, surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses,
grateful for our heritage, aware of the sacrifice of our fathers in the faith, confessing that apart from us, their work cannot be made perfect, do dedicate ourselves anew to the worship and service of Almighty God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Peter, if you come up and say a prayer of dedication for us, we'd appreciate that.
Pastor Ray, I want to thank you for leading us so well. God has given you a wonderful heart, not just for these people and for this region, but for this day. And we trust you, and we are grateful that you lead us. As I lead us in prayer on this day, I want to give you the words of A.W. Tozer. As we think about the shoulders that we stand upon, embarking on this new chapter together, we need today a fresh spirit of anticipation that springs out of the promises of God. We must declare war on the mood of non-expectation and come together with childlike faith. Only then can we know again the beauty and wonder of the Lord's presence among us. Let's pray. Lord, it is truly humbling in my spirit as a brother to these brothers and sisters who gather here today to think of the generations of leaders and lives upon whom we stand today. And Lord, while we agree and we acknowledge that the church is not a building, the church is your people, we trusted to us to do your work, including the buildings that were mentioned in our pastor's comments today, including this building. And Lord, as we dedicate this place afresh and anew as our home for primary worship as the Reach Wesleyan Church family, we claim this today as sacred ground for your work. For the fact that we can continue to be part of that mission, because it is not Daniel Hilliard's mission. It is your mission. It is your great commission. And we thank you for this wonderful day, and we claim it in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
If you take the hymnal again, stand with me. You've got to stand on this one. I want to hear it. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's praise the Lord.
There is no shadow of turning.
There is a potluck over at the Hillier Building immediately following. You can go explore the classrooms and see what's been done back there. Or you can go and just be blessed on your way. May you, God, our Father, continue to go with us day by day, hour by hour. May you continue to bless us and teach us. May you continue to guide us and lead us as we go out into our communities, as we go back to our families and homes, as we serve you day by day. We thank you, Father, for this day, this celebration, for most of us, for your presence and the life that you give. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. One thing you meant most.
Great job, man.
Thank you.